But we should get started. It's a great pleasure to have with us, folks visiting us from Google. So Sushant Jain was a graduate from University of Wisconsin a while ago, and then he's been in
Washington.
Washington? Yes, Washington. What did I say? I said Wisconsin, sorry. Washington, Seattle, a while ago. And he is going to give us a talk. He belongs to the Google ad team, specifically focusing on large-scale distributed infrastructure. So just when we thought all the caching problems and all the replication problems were solved, he's going to tell us that it's not been solved. So the troubles that they are going through in building the new system. So he'll tell us a little bit about that. And interestingly, there was a consistency issue that came up in the morning and organizing the talk. Some of you may have got a double message saying Google Talk canceled. Clearly he's here, it's not canceled, he's live, he's very much there. So that was a tech part of the talk, with I think 6 to 8 sessions sort of that were canceled, and the talk is not canceled. Luckily, I don't think most of you caught it because you're here, so that's good. All right, let's welcome Sushant and the Google team.
Hello everyone, thanks for coming here today. And thanks for the introduction, Sharad. So as Sharad mentioned, I worked in search ads infrastructure at Google. And search ads is a very important part for Google, both because it drives large part of revenue, and also it's an important part of overall ecosystem from how it enables many other businesses. Search ads has many components. You know, it's a very complex system. There are parts around how we build efficient auction algorithms. There are parts about how we manage advertiser budgets, parts about how we run experiments because people are continuously trying new ideas. And then the part that I'm going to talk about today is a subsystem called Dynamo. And Dynamo is basically a low latency data distribution system from database to servers. And we will see what kind of challenges we face in building this subsystem. Here is an outline for today's talk. I will start by giving you some motivation and background. We'll go into system requirements for what we are trying to do. Then I will deep dive into one particular part of the Dynamo system called incremental updates. And towards the end of the talk, I will talk about some practical considerations for running this system and conclude the talk with some future work. Let's start by looking at the big picture, which connects serving system and databases. In this picture, I'm showing you an end user on the left, which is doing a query, let's say cotton socks, on Google search. That query, after going through various systems, end up hitting ad servers, which are responsible for showing an ad, suitable ad for this query. One simple way you can build such a system is that these ad servers at query time, when they receive a new query, they go and read the database, which stores information about all the advertisers to retrieve possible ads. And you know, in this case, it shows a specific ad, organic cotton socks, that's returned. On the right-hand side, I'm also showing how advertisers offline are basically interacting with the database and adding ads to the system. What are some issues with this simplistic view of the world? One is scale. So the serving system that we're talking about has to handle large input queries per second. We are talking about hundreds of thousands of queries per second. And processing each query would technically require you to evaluate all possible ads. Effectively, you may have to read the whole database in this simplistic view. This may translate to billions of lookups per second. This will be really expensive to read all this data remotely. Second, we want ad computation to be really fast. Typically, we have very small latency budget, you know, a few hundreds of milliseconds. And going outside of your server to read all these ads is just way too expensive. So for both scale and latency reasons, we really need access to this database data in memory of the servers, so that we can do these computations efficiently. If you go back to our original picture, this is, let me show how Dynamo fits in there. Effectively, we have, the Dynamo is now in the middle of ad servers and database, and it's trying to synchronize data between these two parts without waiting for a query. so that when a new query comes, these ad servers can access this data locally and, you know, compute ad efficiently. And the source of truth is still the database. Before I talk more about challenging the system, let me introduce some basic Google Ads terminology, which I may refer, you know, throughout the talk. One is a customer. There are many customers in, you know, the Google Ads system, and a given customer, say eBay or Apple, it's the overall owner of all ads. It will have account level features such as, say, the credit card, you know, on which you will charge for all the ads, or it may also have some check boxes such as, you know, enable all my ads or disable all my ads. And we'll see how it plays an important role, you know, in subsequent slides. A customer typically has, they have many campaigns which target different business objectives. For example, if you have a customer called Best Buy, it may have a campaign for Chromebooks and a separate, you know, campaign for laptop accessories. Then we have actual ads. And again, a campaign can have many ads. It can have various pieces of information such as, you know, the text of the ad or URL, the specific you know, landing page that the user will see if they click on the ad. And another aspect is keyword, which is trying to give targeting information, like on what search query should this ad really show on. Next few slides, I'm going to talk about some challenges in, you know, synchronizing.
So who specifies that? Like what keywords should the ad show upon? Is that something automated?
It is specified by the advertiser. There are, you know, subsystems or there are sub-products where you want to automatically generate those keywords. But yeah, in this case, in large part of cases, they specify that. And yeah, please feel free to interrupt me, you know, if you have any specific questions, and I can, you know, take them as we go. So next few slides, I'm going to talk about some challenges in, you know, the synchronization between the two ends. One is, of course, a scale of the serving system. We just have large number of servers. And also, we will have different type of servers. Some just handle URLs, we talked about, some just handle keywords, just to manage the overall complexity and optimization. And also, these servers are spread geographically, because we want the ad serving system to be very close to the end user to have a, you know, lower latency, which means that this data has to be shipped over, you know, long haul links. Another interesting aspect which we'll see in the next few slides is that the layout is actually different between the serving, you know, data structures that we built and database. In my initial slide, I kind of showed you, look, how we are just trying to copy data from one place to another. But I will show you a specific example that it's more than just copying data from one place to another. So here are some you know, reasons on why the layout is different between the two ends. Here on the left-hand side, I'm showing you a database view. There are two tables here. The first table is showing you just that there are three ads, 500, 500, 502, and, you know, there are some ad text. And the second table is showing you customer level information, which geo, say, it's the customer is targeting all its ad, and whether the customer itself is active or inactive. Right, so there are two tables on the left-hand side. The serving system, on the other hand, if you combine all this information, may actually just have a single table, which is, first of all, only focusing on active ads in the system. So all the ads for customer ID 1 are dropped on the right-hand side. And also note that how we have joined two tables, the ad table and the customer geo table, to combine all the information in a single data structure on the right-hand side. In practice, we have seen that a lot of data in databases is actually not active because customers come and go, they run out of budget, sometimes they are, you know, marked as fraudsters. So being able to only load active data in the serving system is really important. On database, everything is stored on disk and is much cheaper. But in serving system, everything is not just loaded in memory, it's also accessed. You know, you have to evaluate all these options. So it's really important to flush out all these ads, and we really try to be, you know, let's say, very aggressive in not loading entities that we are not very interested in. Let's take another example on how the layout could be really different between the two systems. On the left-hand side, I'm showing you a database view where there are three keywords, basically, say flowers, phone, you know, and that two customers, one and two, they both are interested in, you know, bidding on flowers. The serving view, on the other hand, can actually, you know, if you think about it, would invert this data. Because when a query comes, let's say flower, we want to look at, say, all the customers which are interested in flowers. So it has effectively, you know, we have an inverted map when it comes to the serving view. We have flower and both, there are two keywords, 11 and 21, you know, which are interested in this keyword and similarly for both. So I hope, you know, these kind of examples show you that we're not just talking about simple synchronization between the two systems, but there is a lot of interesting transformations also going between the two systems. Just quickly want to go over some other reasons why, you know, we have layout differences. The way data is organized in database often is optimized for the UI performance. And the way table could be, all the data for a given customer typically resides on one server so that transactions can be fast. But we talked about how on the serving system we have very different types of servers dealing with each specific type of data. So the data gets really split in the serving system. Also the compression techniques, they may be very different between, you know, in serving system and in the database because of the cost trade-offs difference between RAM and disk. We may also, as part of this transformation, annotate, you know, the database data with external data sources in order to help compute better ads. An interesting example is, you know, we may want to determine language of an ad text, which requires some more external data sources, and ship this language as part of the serving data structure. You know, this brings me to talk about goals and requirements of this dynamo system that you know you're trying to build. So the goal is really both to transform and synchronize data from database to server. And let's talk about some requirements. The first one is we want low data propagation latency and high reliability. You know, if database is changing continuously and we want those changes to reflect quickly in servers worldwide. Like in common case, we are targeting, you know, less than 1 minute of delay. And this is really important because, say, from advertiser perspective, right, if you're adding new ads, or let's say you're pausing your account, do you really want to, your expectation is that, look, if I have paused my account, Google is not going to charge for my ads anymore, right? They will stop showing my ads. So it's really important for us to make sure that this latency is really low. The second requirement is that we have to build a system which can handle high change rate. I really want to highlight that a lot of changes that we see are not just from advertisers. There are a lot of internal Google systems who are actually continuously changing this internal database to annotate it. For example, there are auto-bidding systems which are trying to tweak bids in order to optimize advertiser performance. So if you look at the full breadth of the system, the number of changes which are happening in the database are enormous and very, very varied. So high change rate, and also these individual changes can be really expensive to process. Let's take an example. Imagine a customer who is, you know, a new customer which has set up, say, billions of ads or, you know, say, thousands of ads. Right, but they may not have still added their credit card information because they're still setting up their account. Everything is good so far. We are not loading any of these, say, you know, thousands of ads in the serving system. The moment they add credit card information, all these ads are suddenly, you know, active. So this single click or single bool change on the database translates to, you know, a much more expensive computation for this dynamo system as well as lots of events on the serving system. And this has been one of the biggest challenges for us, especially because our advertiser size also has really high variance. Some advertisers, such as, you know, as an example, eBay, have lots and lots of ads, whereas some small, you know, businesses, like, you know, a mom and pop shop may have very few number of ads. So there is high variance in the load that we have to handle when we talk about a specific event. this is basically that a single change, such as this bool change, could translate to reading tens of gigabytes of data. We also care a lot about eventual consistency and correctness. You know, we don't want to miss any updates. In fact, we have an additional requirement that we want a first-in, first-out delivery of updates at an individual customer level. So for example, if you want to create an app, and then a few minutes later, you disable all of your accounts. So we want to respect that order of updates as when they're delivered to the serving system. If we reverse the order, if you disable the whole account first, and then push the new ad, it will not do the right thing. Another aspect is we want a system which can handle restarts of these serving binaries. Note, remember that you know they have loaded all this data in their memory, but they are going to restart either because of failures or because we are just say pushing new code changes. And these restarts actually happen fairly often. You know, in some cases, you know, multiple times a week. And when they restart, should they read all the incremental updates since the start of the you know time, or how do they really quickly reconstruct the state? And these restarts are not just you know one server at a time. We can have a single cluster which is thousands of servers. In an emergency, that may quickly want to you know that may we may have a quick restart of all the instances. And so we have specialized subsystems which handle that part of the problem. And we also want to have a flexible programming framework to support those different type of transformations that we earlier talked about. The overall dynamo system is pretty wide, right? Because we have to handle these different type of requirements. In this slide, I'm just giving you a bird's eye view of what type of subsystems within dynamo we have. And in the subsequent part of the talk, we'll talk about what you know, specific things. One aspect of the dynamo system is programming API. Like this is where all the business logic goes in. What tables to load, how to express what changes are of interest, how to join multiple tables, how to access remote data sources. That's you know that's that part of the subsystem. Another piece is called full extraction. What we do is that we, for each server, you know, we create specific data sets on disk which can be loaded quickly. And we generate these data sets every few hours. So that if you restart, your data is not you know older than few hours. So that subsystem is called full extraction. And that plays an important role in the ecosystem as well. Then we have incremental extraction, which is going to keep per server update stream so that the data is fresh in the server's memory, and we'll talk more about it. The overall dynamo ecosystem relies heavily on files, both for full extraction and incremental extraction. Because we are generating and handling these events in one place and usually adding new files or pushing data to files. And we have a subsystem called copy service, which effectively take these files from one place and distribute them to hundreds of data centers across long haul links in an efficient manner, for example, so that same data does not go over the MAN link multiple times. And you know, and this happens in real time. There's another subsystem about data loader, because we have multiple replicas for the same event, right? Mostly for high reliability. On the serving system side, we have to select, okay, if you have multiple copies, what's the best version to load? And sometimes some of these files can be corrupt also. So this component, again, not going to talk in detail today, helps in discovering and loading correct data into the data structure. So next part of the talk, I'm going to talk more about the incremental extraction piece of the system and specific problems inside it. So this is a very simplified view of how we can build an incremental extraction system. Let's take a look at this. Again, on the left-hand side, we have database, and on the right-hand side, we have multiple instances of serving system spread geographically. And On the left, I'm showing you in the dotted box one extraction replica. There are multiple replicas doing hot, like doing exactly the same thing for higher reliability. And in this one extraction replica, one way to build such a, you know, incremental extraction system is to have a large worker pool which will handle these events. And we can have one dedicated worker per destination server destination shard. In this example, I'm showing you two servers, S1 and S2, and let's say they have two shards. So we can have dedicated workers which will handle each of this input event, read data from database, figure out what is each of these server needs, and append, you know, and create that output for that server. And again, we are using files to create this output. As more events are getting handled, each of these dedicated servers are appending to those files. And a dedicated worker per file makes sense because we cannot have multiple workers writing to the same file. So that's a very simplified view. If you want to create 100, if you want to update 100 servers, have 100 workers, and same event is handled by 100 workers. And in this simplified view, you can see that we will have lots of update stream files. To visualize, the number of files we are talking about here is a cross product of number of extraction replicas, number of server types, number of shards, you know, how for each server type, and also number of serving data centers, because we copy each file locally to each serving data center so that they don't have to remotely read the data. One interesting part to note is that a single server and shard may still have multiple replicas to handle load. And they can actually read the same file. We don't need a dedicated file per instance of the server. This really helps in managing state because the extraction part is not aware of, you know, how many replicas of a given server are there in the system. Let's see some limitations of this very simplified incremental extraction system, and we'll try to solve some of these problems in the subsequent slides. One is efficiency. In the previous model, we have a lot of servers dedicated for a destination server. And the same event can actually generate data for many destination servers. And ideally, we want to have a shared processing of that database event. So for example, ideally, if a customer gets enabled, we want to handle that event once and figure out all the output for all the server types and then somehow read out the data appropriately. Also, in the simplistic view, you know, we are just processing each changes, and this can be very expensive when there are a lot of changes in the system and batching is kind of desired for multiple changes. The second aspect that let's now I will go in detail is how do we do per customer FIFO delivery in an efficient manner. The simplest version to achieve is let's just globally order all the changes in the databases and process them one by one. Right? A single, you know, you can imagine a single queue or a single SQL study space. Well, there are two problems with this. One is there's a scaling bottleneck in trying to globally order all the changes. There's literally transaction throughput limitation if you have to globally order everything. The second problem is that, you know, if we are trying to process a change which takes really long time, let's say, a large customer with million of ad is enabled, then until that change is completely finished processing, we won't be able to process all the subsequent changes. So it kind of blocks the queue. As I earlier alluded, because customer sizes, you know, vary significantly, the processing time of these events really have high variance. So this single queue model where doesn't work very well. And even for a single customer, I want to highlight that some changes can be really cheap to process versus others. For example, if you just add a new ad in your existing account of 100,000 ads, that's cheap to process. But if you enable all your full account, right, then you have to actually flush all the ads, and that can be much more expensive. So instead of doing this global ordering of all the changes, let's see what else we can do. Another approach is that, can we really do per customer ordering? Right? We have really large number of customers. What happens is that the serving system needs to know the state of all the queues that we create. Where are they? You know, how far we have processed the changes. So if we have per customer queues, you know, like, then that really creates high overhead, high RAM overhead on this control state tracking in the serving system. And because we have many, many instances of these servers, that becomes really expensive. And this actually is more tricky than this, because number of customers are also varying the system. Either they are getting disabled or enabled, so the number of queues are really varying as well. The approach that we take is, we shard the customers into some finite number of bundles using a simple mod sharding. And effectively we have, let's suppose if we have say 100 shards, then effectively we have 100 queues in the system. And these queues or bundles become the isolation domain. And this
so
will become...
So for you, what's a customer? Like a large company, is that one customer or is it multiple customers?
So that's an interesting question, but let's, for the purpose of now, let's assume they are a single, you know, eBay is one customer.
The reason I'm asking
yes.
is, yeah, if eBay is one customer, then multiple people are placing the ad possibly at the same time.
Yes.
So isn't there multiple interactions concurrently going on?
Yeah, absolutely. So there are multiple updates for a single customer also, but the way the database is structured, that, those are, they are all sequentialized within that customer.
But isn't that an overkill is what I'm trying to figure
so
out.
So I think what happens in practice is that these big companies, they actually end up creating multiple customer accounts. So, you know, that's actually adds another level of challenge which we have not addressed so far that we'll talk about in the future world. But even within this constraint, we do have some customers which really have millions of ads and some customers which have, you know, tens of ads or even just one ad. So let's talk, just visually look at this bundle arrangement, right? Here I'm showing you on the left hand side, you know, four changes in the database at time T1, T2, and T3, right? We have customer IDs 0, 1, and 2. And customer 0 is changing twice. If you use a simple, use a simple mod sharding, say customer ID mod 2, we can basically split all the changes into two queues, in bundle 0 queue and a bundle 1 queue, and then process changes within each queue one by one. Effectively, with such an arrangement, customer 1 is isolated from whatever happens in the customer 0 queue, in the bundle 0 queue. But even with this approach, where we have split into multiple queues, you can see that it's still hard to achieve parallel processing, because even within the queue, you're going over everything one by one. And even within the single queue, we can still have the blocking issue. You know, we have definitely improved the problem that instead of having single queue, we have now, say, hundreds of queues. But we have not eliminated that issue. The way we achieve parallel processing with FIFO, let's see how we do that. What we basically do is that we separate the notion of extraction and how we emit output in the output files. Basically, we will have a process pool which is allowed to look ahead in the queue and, you know, start processing these events even out of order. And in fact, these worker pools, the extraction worker pools, they can pick changes from any bundle level queue.
That's a question.
Yeah, oh, go ahead. Yeah.
Do you exploit any aspect of prioritization, or some customers or some queues or some updates more important than others?
Not so far. Yeah, I think we don't have an explicit notion for that. You know, we kind of assume all customers are equal, and that's again definitely something which is subject to debate and to improvement and, you know, tweaking future. Yeah. So we can have a process pool which is extracting out of order. And instead of writing directly to the files, these out of order operation output can be written into a temporary storage. And then there's a separate set of jobs which are used to emit to these output files in the FIFO order. We call them mergers. And these mergers are basically what, they are sticky for each server type and shard. So if you have 100 update streams on the serving side, we will have 100 mergers. But we can have still have only, say, 50 workers who are extracting and writing to this temporary store. Again, let's take a, look at the picture and see, is the difference between the parallel processing and the FIFO processing. Again, we have a simplified example where we have only three changes on the very left-hand side. And if you do FIFO extraction and FIFO delivery, the blue part is, okay, look, let's extract it, write it to file, the yellow part. Extract, and then write, extract in this way, right? And below the dotted line, if we are allowed to have parallel extraction, right, we can actually have workers processing these changes C0, C2, and C0 in parallel. And when it comes to writing output to the files, because you want the ordering, the FIFO ordering of the actual output scene, that can be sequentialized as shown here. And so this model allows us to, you can see, have much higher throughput and performance than a strict FIFO extraction and a, FIFO delivery model. Actually, even in this example, there are some challenges and there is still a head of line blocking. Again, the same example that we just talked about, and we are parallelly extracting C0, C2, and C0, right? But we can see that the C2 chain finished much earlier in the flow. And it is being blocked by the first C0 chain because of our desire to have FIFO delivery across all the changes. But we only need FIFO delivery at a per customer level. These different customers are completely independent. So what can we do so that the chain C2 can be delivered quickly? And the intuition for the solution that we use is that we need to understand the dependency structure between all the changes. If we know that chain C2, if it's finished, we identify all the customers in that chain. In this example, I'm just showing you one customer, but a given processing unit will have multiple customers. So we identify what all belongs to that chain. And that change can be delivered if any of those customers don't have any pending change. So again, C2 can be delivered because C2 doesn't have a pending change, but the last C0 change, that cannot be delivered because it has a previous pending change. So by understanding this dependency structure, right, between all the pending changes and the change that just finished, we can achieve more optimization. This is, again, just a visual view of what is possible if we can do this parallel extraction, but out of order delivery by accounting for dependency structure. Like below the dotted line, I'm showing you how the once C2 is extracted, it can be just delivered. But both the C0 changes, we have to wait until the first one is finished before it can be delivered. And from C2 point of view, this new option will have much higher performance than the previous one. This sounds simple, but there are actually more subtle details when it comes to this out-of-order delivery. So from a single extraction replica point of view, right, this output order is reasonable. It is consistent. For a given customer, everything is in order. But now, remember, we have this hot replicas for high reliability. And the output order between these different clusters may not exactly match. Again, this is because our ordering really depends on these performance times, right? I mean, what takes long, what takes less, and when it's ready. And clearly across different replicas, these performance will vary and it's not going to be consistent. And if you don't have consistent output across these multiple replicas, it creates kind of more issues on the serving system when you have to go between, say, one replica to another replica, because now the order is not matching exactly. And every time we have to make a trade-off, we tend to put more complexity on the extraction side of the system as compared to the serving system. Because on the serving side, we have thousands of servers doing exactly the same thing. So if we can solve that on the extraction side, it's usually much more efficient. And the high-level intuition for the solution that we use to work around this is that we actually have another stage to reorder this final output across these different colors. It's mostly about rewriting already extracted output in slightly different order so that it is consistent across different colors. So I think this is our last slide for the incremental extraction piece. Just to tie back all the few other things that we talked about, where in the one replica that I'm showing, previously we only had a single worker pool, but in practice we actually have different worker pools, either focus on extraction, like the purple part, or just writing to files, which is the merger part. And we also have something called a dispatcher, which is basically coordinating these workers and mergers. In this picture, I'm also showing you some parts which are outside of the replica part, which are basically creating this per bundle queues. And that's, it's not really replicated, rather it's kind of mass selected so that globally we have a single ordering across all these changes. Well, this brings me to the last part of the talk, and I'm going to just talk about some of the practical considerations, that we face in running, this complex system. One of the important parts, right, is for us to keep the system free from bugs, right? And unexpected issues are, they're kind of unavoidable in these complex systems. And also we want to be in a place where we can evolve these systems rapidly, both architecturally as well as business logic point of view. So this is a much more rapidly moving piece. And from developers' point of view, like say from my team point of view, it's also important how we can run the system in a way where we are not worried about that system may not break as we change it. And we use three strategies to kind of manage this rapid evolution. One is around prevention, detection, and mitigation. And let's talk about these different techniques. On the prevention side, we pay a lot of importance to robust testing of the overall system. The unit testing is an obvious one, but we also have end-to-end integration tests, which literally allows you to simulate the overall system by inserting an ads into the database, running the dynamo system, running the servers, and even validating that the right ads are shown. Now, this actually is pretty complex because there are a lot of pieces involved in the full system, and we use mocks as suitable. Another aspect is that we pay emphasis to replicating the production environment in a more development environment, where we can just push any arbitrary code that we want. We basically mirror our production setup. This is actually costly, but again, in order for us to have high development velocity, that becomes really important. For this project in particular, it's actually slightly easier because large part of the functionality is about reading data from the database, seeing new changes. It's mostly read-only operations. And then we write output to these files. And for the development environment, we can simply write to a different set of files. So it's kind of possible to run at full scale in a development environment by reading all the changes from the database. For prevention, another technique is simply to deploy changes in phases. For example, we can serve only a fraction of user traffic, say only 1% of traffic before we go fully. Also, we have hot deployment model for our extraction. If you're doing a big change, we can just push our change to one data center, wait for a few weeks, right? Make sure everything is ironed out before we go to all data centers. So in such a case, having this hot really helps us in iterating fast and develop new features. Then detection is also an important part. There are two types of issues. One is performance issues, for which we can rely on end-to-end delay alerts. In the serving system, we can see when a change finally arrives at it, how long was the delay. And we, for that, we basically just push the timestamp of the, you know, when the change was created. One interesting part is, you know, how do you know when you have completely missed an event? You know, delays are, you know, in a queuing system, you can compute delay only after you have seen an event. And for that, we actually rely on either probes or, you know, there are some specific database enhancements we are doing so that we can figure out, say, a low watermark concept that, and scan the database to make sure that the low watermark of the database and the low watermark of our system are, you know, in sync. Detecting CRUD issues is actually much more tricky. And we do something interesting here that I, you know, wanted to share. Like suppose, let's take a hypothetical example where, you know, suppose because of a bug, we simply miss a delete event, you know, and ad continues to serve. What we end up doing is that every time an ad is served, we log the ad. You know, that's very important. And we have an offline job which look at these logs and checks that when that ad was served, right, say 3 hours ago, whether at that 3 hours ago, whether that customer was enabled. So it's a pretty elaborate set of checks we do. And this actually requires us to be able to have snapshotted view of database, like so that we can read the state of the database, you know, 3 hours ago. And even building this subsystem requires, you know, is a kind of complete separate subsystem which allows us to do a timestamped read of the database in past. Then we also have some techniques of mitigation. Even if you identify a problematic event, right, and let's say we have fixed the bug and everything is correct, like, but the serving system, again, there are thousands of servers worldwide, right? Like, how do we fix their in-memory state? And the way, in most cases, what we do is that we have fake events to reprocess the whole customer, which will result in, you know, new updates being generated and, you know, kind of swapping the existing state. In some cases, of course, it's not possible because, you know, the bug can affect large number of entities, or we just, you know, it may be hard to figure out which entities are getting affected. In which case, we simply re-trigger, you know, the full snapshot of data and restart all the servers. And all these techniques, you know, kind of play, they have a, you know, a role to play in our day-to-day operation, right? I mean, some get used, you know, only once a few months, and some gets used, you know, once every few weeks. Second last slide, just talking about some of the challenges ahead. You know, I think Sharon mentioned this already. You know, a single entity such as eBay, they actually owns many customer IDs. And often when they do changes, they actually change all those customer IDs. And that really creates a disproportionate amount of load in our system. And how can we detect and isolate impact of such changes? Either using some of the prioritization techniques, you know, or, you know, simply, you know, having a separate worker pool for them. High-level APIs to make it easier to express business logic is also something we are constantly evolving as the business logic is getting more and more complicated. Running as a service, you know, Dynamo is a general purpose system of, you know, basically transforming and synchronizing database. But a lot of design decisions that we have taken are kind of originated with Google Ads as a use case. But now that Google has also grown, we are actively working in many other teams so that they can just use our technology and try it out. There are a few challenges here. One is coming up with right APIs so that we can separate out what is business logic versus what is the core infrastructure logic. Like when we initially developed the system, everything was one single, you know, system where business logic is happening somewhere and copying is happening somewhere. So those boundaries are not very clear. And if we are going to handle many clients, you know, how do we provide resource isolation across clients also becomes much more interesting. For Google Ads, you know, data keeps growing and we need to support, you know, kind of 10x growth. So that's always, you know, an ongoing kind of effort for us. Like we use file systems in unique ways. You know, we are one of the biggest source of files for our file systems, and we are kind of special exceptions from file system folks. And whether the whole system, the current model can scale to 10x is kind of, you know, something for us that we are actively evaluating because the bottlenecks keep changing as we in the system. Another aspect, you know, is kind of better data generation. Our current system is kind of stateless. You know, if a customer does multiple changes, like the same change, we actually react to all those changes, and even though it may not change any output, we still create output because we don't know the state of the service system. This leads to duplicate and spiky output, and we have different projects trying to investigate kind of our options for handling these kind of scenarios. Okay, in conclusion, this data distribution system is really critical to building fast and scalable serving system. I hope I have convinced you that it has many hard problems, and also it kind of spans four array of system technologies, closer to databases, closer to copying, closer to interacting with multiple servers, and you know, I invite you know many of you to join us and solve these you know kind of challenges and you know collaborate with us. Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. So what type of guarantees do you make to the customers about from the time they think they've submitted a request to the time it hits the you being used to serve ads, and then have you considered like rate limiting or batching to solve the technical challenges or make it easier?
So I think from customer's point of view, they expect the changes to become live in a few minutes, right? And rate controlling is tricky because sometimes some of those changes are driven by internal jobs. So for internal jobs, it's easier for us to rate control. So for example, we often do work with the teams who are doing internal changes to slow down all the inject changes into the database. So that is certainly, definitely, you know, an important part of the kind of solution. One challenge we have seen is that there are literally, you know, hundreds of teams, you know, interacting with Google Ads. And it's not really scalable for us, you know, as an infrastructure provider to chase all these teams to do rate control. And the interface is really database. We are not in a position, we are more like a reader of the database. Like they do not go us before they write to the database. So yes, I know, we do have some principles on rate control, and we try to kind of, you know, use them whenever we can, but it is not something that, you know, lets us survive, I would say, because of the heterogeneity. And in general, you know, we want to be in a place where most changes do not have to face the rate control as well. Does that answer your question?
Actually, before we have further questions, one quick thing, announcement. So some of you are looking for the code, and it's right there on the slide, right here. They did it for us, this one, okay? The capital G being important. So, all right, so now you have the code.
Hi, thank you for the talk. So I have a question about the extraction part. So how does your extraction work? Like, is it the database push the redo logs to your system, or your system read all the tables and join them and get the delta part?
Yes, so there are two parts. One is that every time a change happens, database provides some native functionality to record what exactly changed. What rows change, what table change, what was the old value, what was the new value. So we use that information to figure out what part of the full database to read. But again, imagine a change where a customer just, you know, flips from inactive to active. So just look at the change record. It will have simply saying that, okay, one table, one row change from, say, false to true. But what we need to do in reaction to that event is actually read the whole subtree of the customer and flush that out. So it's a combination of both relying on the actual change log and using that to figure out what part of the database to kind of read. And there's a pretty sophisticated and kind of internal language to express this relationship between what's happening inside change, how it translates to what set of rows and database kind of to read.
So that part is also and your API provided to the logic.
Yes.
Based business logic.
Yes. Yes.
So it seems like going from extraction that you're flattening out
yes.
the database. So
yes.
why couldn't you then just chunk large updates into smaller ones and combine smaller ones into like a fixed chunk size? So instead of having
yes.
a large customer with 10,000 ads that you're
yes.
that are all flat that you're trying to update,
yes.
you would break it into 10 chunks of 1,000. And instead of having 1,000 smaller customers with one change, chunk them into.
So I think so for the we do batch across multiple small changes. So that we already do because for efficiency. The question regarding you know can we split a big change into smaller units? That is a tricky one. Like the reason it's hard is because. Let's see what happens on the serving system. Often the model that they have is a swap model. Again, to make it easier for you to build that serving data structure, on the other hand, the easiest way to reason is that you have all the new data and you just swap it. So that, you know, as you try to balance ease of swappability on the serving system, it kind of puts more requirement for us to consolidate everything together.
Makes sense, thank you.
Hey, you have a question?
Yeah. So, is the system worldwide?
Yes, the serving system is.
Okay, so the tradition is to have a master database and many replicas worldwide.
Yes.
So is this something similar or?
So the serving system, right, the you know, which has this replica that like that's a, you know, say hundreds of data centers, right? Correct. I think the question you're asking is that can we replicate the database also to all the
and do you actually?
So so we don't, and one is like what we do, we don't replicate our database aggressively to all the places in the world, right? Our model, again, this is, you know, some of these may change in the future, but our current model is really that databases are, you know, located in few places in North America, right, correct? And you do these complex transformations, you know, in say few places here, and then fan out the data to, you know, many, many places in Asia or Europe and stuff like that. And I think if you're thinking, why can't we just replicate database, you know, much more widely, it really kind of stems from the observation that the exact view that a serving system needs is slightly, not just slightly, is kind of noticeably different from what the original database had, right? If you look at the examples of filtering or inverted maps. So even if database was literally replicated as is today, right? It will not meet the current requirements. An alternate paradigm is indeed that can we have, you know, more sophisticated database transformation, like database to database, right, kind of abstractions, and then replicate that transformed database to all these kind of data centers, and the serving system maybe can directly access those transformed databases. So possible, but yeah, currently we don't. Yes, please.
Thanks for presentation. I have a question about the consistency requirement for
yes.
the incremental extraction. So you mentioned that in each bundle you have implemented dependency analysis
yes.
to ensure that dependent changes are delivered in order.
Yes.
Then why do you still care about the total order among replicas? Like
yes. I think I must admit that I'm glossing over some of the details there. Here and maybe we can talk offline. But I think again it stems, you know, remember we have multiple replicas also,
yeah.
right? So imagine that you're reading data from one replica, which has some consistent order, right? So everything is good. And now that file is corrupted. Now in order for you to go from, you know, where you are in that stream, right? If you know that all the files have exactly the same order, you can much more easily jump into the other file. So because of this hot nature, that new requirement comes in that even though a single file is perfectly valid, right, assuming it is not corrupted, going from one file to another file, you know, introduce this, you know, kind of subtlety.
I think the problem is that we since we use files, the files introduce another sequence, right? So it's pseudo sequence. And so sort of like it's global, right? The file is like one order and you need to read it only in one sequence. And you need to find the point where you need to fall back into that file. And that's like, it's like you are now, like you said, using dependence analysis, you create as many independent streams, but you are again sequencing them into a single file. You need to find the location where you can seek into so that you again sort of like align with your, where you're coming from. So.
Any last question?
Please, yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Along the same line, is file getting corrupted that prevalent?
Yeah, it is absolutely, you know, prevalent doesn't matter, it happens.
Because of the scale.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I think, you know, I'm like the number of files that we use is literally infinite, right? And even if it happens once a week, that's absolutely not acceptable, right? Maybe if it happens once or 2 years, you know, maybe that we can get away with that, but usually it just doesn't work that way.
I remember there was like, this is sort of related, with scale, anything which is improbable will eventually end up happening, right? I even remember there was a paper published by Google that because of cosmic rays, some hard disk getting corrupted happens in Google in real, something like that was published a few years back.
So there are two further things I want to say on this very slide. One is because Jean is there, and don't take it off.
No, I just.
Sorry, it was. All right. So one is because Jean is in the audience, so I thought one is meant for him, sort of. So there is a security leak in this slide. Somebody, can you notice it?
Sure.
Where is it?
The footer, the right hand side.
The right hand side button says confidential and proprietary.
Ain't anymore.
All right. So we now know the Google secrets. All right.
Template.
Sorry, second aspect of it is there's an interesting sort of a thing is self pitch, I guess. There's a last part which they're mentioning is come and solve the unsolved challenges. But before you do that, you need to take a course in transaction dispute systems. Lucky for you, it's getting offered next quarter.
Yeah, please take that course before you come.
Let's thank our speakers.